In a typical PHP application, you'll need to connect to a database, send an email, use an API, and so on. Doing things like this requires credentials, like a username and password, or an API key. Secret values like these should not be stored with your PHP code. Take this code for example. Here we have four variables, containing the connection details for connecting to a database. These values are hard-coded in this file. If we check this file into source code control, for example a Git repository, then these values can be seen by anyone who has access to this source code. This could be any developer in your organization, some of which shouldn't have access to secret data like this. If this is open source, then anyone can see them. Also, when this code is moved to a different server, for example if you're developing locally, then deploying your code to production, then you'll need to change this file. The same is true for any file that contains credentials like this. So instead of storing values like this in here, let's store them somewhere else. Let's create a new file called config.php. This is a PHP file, so let's start with the PHP opening tag. Defining PHP constants might seem like a good choice, as these will be available globally. So let's use the define function to define a constant for each database connection value. Back in the original script, we can now remove these hard-coded variables and require the file that we just added. Then, instead of the individual variables that we were using before, we can use the constants we just defined. The advantage of doing it like this is that it's simple and quick, as it's just PHP code that doesn't require any additional parsing. The disadvantages of using constants, though, is that you're polluting the global namespace, which can cause compatibility problems if any library defines a constant with the same name. So instead of using constants, let's create a variable containing an associative array, with an element with an index of database. It's typical to do something like this, so that this array can contain configuration settings for different things, like the database, email server, API keys, and so on. This will in turn contain an associative array, with elements for each of the database credentials. Then, back in the index script, instead of the constants, we can use the values from the config variable that's defined in the other file. The main downside of using a PHP script for configuration settings is that you might be tempted to add conditional statements or other code in here that returns different values based on the environment. Configuration settings should just be simple values. An alternative to this is to use a different format for the config file, for example, an .ini file. So let's create a new file called config.ini. As this isn't PHP code, we don't need the PHP opening tag. The file format is the same as the one used by phpdotenv, so we can define a section inside square brackets, and each setting separated from its value by an equals sign. Back in the main script, we can use the built-in parseInifile function to load and parse the contents of this file. If we pass in true as the second argument, it will return an associative array with a separate element for each section. So this will result in the config variable containing the same array as before, so we don't need to change the code below. The advantage of a format like this is that you can't add PHP code to it, and it stays nice and simple. Other formats you could use are JSON, which would look like this, or YAML, which would look like this. Like .ini files, these are formats that you can't add executable code to, so they remain as just settings. YAML, though, does require a third-party library in order to parse the files. Another popular option is to store the configuration settings in environment variables. Environment variables are values stored within the operating system that the application can access. This is one of the techniques used to make your application comply with the 12-factor app methodology. These can be set in the operating system itself, using the supplied configuration tools, for example, like this in Windows. These can also be set in the web server configuration, for example in Apache, using the setenv directive. We can then retrieve these values in PHP using the getenv function. Instead of setting these variables directly in the operating system or the web server configuration, it's common to store these in a configuration file called a .env file. So let's create a new file whose name starts with a dot followed by env. In here, we can define the settings that we need. Again, this is not PHP code, just simple syntax for defining values. To read this file, we need a third-party package. One of the most popular packages to do this is phpdotenv. Let's install this using Composer on the command line. So instead of reading the .ini file, to use the package, first let's require Composer's autoloader. Then, to load the .env file we just created, we call the createImmutable method on the .env class in the .env namespace, passing in the folder where the .env file is. Then we call the load method on the object that this returns to load the file. This loads the values from this file into the environment. So the getEnv function will now return these values. We can also use the env superglobal as this is also populated with these values. Now that we're storing these sensitive values in a separate file, this file would be excluded from source code control. For example, if you're using Git, your git ignore file would contain the .env file name. Now that this file isn't part of the source code, we don't know what values should be placed in it. A common technique to overcome this is to create an example.env file that is stored with the source code. Then, whenever someone gets a copy of the source code, they can create a .env file based on this example. You'd also store this file outside of the web root, so it can't be accessed from a web browser. So using .env files to store sensitive credentials is today's current best practice, and is what's recommended. There's a link to all the code shown in this video in the description, along with links to sites shown and relevant documentation. Please don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, and as always, thank you for watching.